Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Can everybody hear me? Hallelujah. Glorious hallelujahs. It's my Spanish hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. This is the day the Lord has made. And we will rejoice because we have a choice, the power to choose. Isn't that remarkable? We actually have a power to choose. We have the power to choose to submit. We have the power to choose to rebel. We have a power to choose to follow light. We have a power to choose to reject light. Everybody has a choice. Turn to your neighbor and say, you choose today. Light or darkness. Life or death. Peace or torment. Ah, oh, yes. Blessings or prosperity? Or curse and destruction? Ooh, snap. You'd have to be an idiot to choose the wrong ones. Oh, glory. Let's go to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew 5. And there are a lot of idiots out there, I'm going to tell you. Glory. Matthew 5, verse 13. We are pressing in deeper and deeper and deeper in the arena of, believe it or not, we are pressing in to more of darkness. That's what Jesus came, right? He pressed into, we're pressing into more of darkness because we're penetrating. So if we're pressing into more of darkness, that means your light must be glowing. Or darkness is going to overtake you. Because the word tells us in the latter days that more darkness will come. And the reason why more darkness is coming is so that we can penetrate it and exchange that darkness, destroy it, and bring light. So that means that, you know, the word says something powerful. It says that your days will be difficult. The path is narrow and difficult. Not wide. And what's happening now is our path is squeezing even tighter. God is requiring more. He's requiring more death. He's requiring more submission. He's requiring more. What we used to get away with before, we won't get away with anymore. Because he's tightening things up. It's like sharpening a sword to make it more pierceable. And Matthew 5 and verse 13, would you read it with me? You are the salt of the earth, but if its salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. By who? Men. In other words, that salt is that preserves. Salt preserves things. You and I are preserved by the presence of God. That's how we are preserved. And because when things begin to happen and the presence of God begins to lift from us, or we begin, because the word says make no place for the devil, things that we think, things we agree with, things that we say, and the presence of God begins to dissipate. Doesn't mean he's given up on us or left us. But that's when the enemy begins to come in. That means our salt, our preservedness is beginning to diminish. And what he's saying is darkness will overtake you. I've seen darkness overtake many people. But go to the next verse. He says, you are the what? Light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand and gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your God in heaven. This is where we're at. It's getting, again, I want to express, darkness is increasing. So God is causing his body, because it's his body. Amen. He is the head. We are the body. He is causing his body to penetrate more of darkness, piercing in more. So are we actually pressing in more into darkness these days? That's why you may find your struggles a little bit more difficult. That's why you might sense that there's more anger in the air. There's more frustration. There's even more fear. And the enemy's trying to get you with doubt and unbelief. He's trying to sway you. This fight is getting harder. But God always prepares us for a harder fight. He gives you bigger boxing gloves. He gives you no more a pistol, a Holy Ghost bazooka, and two of them. He prepares you. He never sends you out without preparing you. Things that we're hearing right now, the message is, because this is training for reigning, amen? This is not religious Bible study. We had enough religion and false doctrines and goofy things. People speaking all kinds of goofy stuff, never knowing the truth because they don't know the truth themselves. Amen? But in this, what's going on right now is that light is so penetrating to overcome darkness, because these last days are wicked and evil. And we're seeing more and more exposure, aren't we? There's more things happening. So it's our responsibility as the body of Christ, to be prepared. The word says, be vigilant. Amen. Be alert. Be consistent. Why? Because your enemy, the devil, is trying to devour whom he can. Well, we're going after him now. We're not supposed to be waiting for him to come after us. We are going after him. It's a time of change. We are going after him. Does everybody get this? And if you're not going after him, he's going to come after you. Even David pursued his enemies to overtake them. This is what God is arising right now. There's an area of desire to go after your enemy. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 1. Is everybody there? Oh, snap. Let's speak it. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you, as it is fitting for saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know, that no fornicator, unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord, and having no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but what? Rather expose them. That's penetrating, isn't it? For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light. Therefore, he says, awake you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And the will of the Lord is that we are the light and the salt, and you and I are to be penetrating, pursuing our enemies. We're to be penetrating into darkness and attacking before they attack us. Remember, God is causing his body to press into darkness. This is where we are at right now. John 9. John chapter 9 and verse 1. This message is called Return of Light. The Return of Light. John 9, verse 1. Is everybody there? Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Now, I love this because you know what? Even they understood about ancestral curses. So they wanted to know whether the sin brought blindness on him. Hello? Or did he receive it from an inheritance of ancestral curses? Does everybody get it? So what's this telling you? What will dull your light? What will blind you? Sin or inheritance? And Jesus answered, said what? Neither man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day or while it is what? Light. The night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. That's why he came. And when he had said these things, he spat on the ground and made clay with the saliva, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with clay. And he said to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is translated sent. So he went and washed and came back what? Seen. Therefore, the neighbors and those who previously had seen he was blind said, is not this he who sat and begged? Some said, this is he. Others said, he's like him. He said, I am he. Therefore, they said to him, how were your eyes opened? And he answered and said, a man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, go to the pool of Siloam and what? Wash. So I went and washed, and I received sight. Your washing and my washing, because Jesus did not shed the blood yet, is through the blood of Christ. After he shed the blood, we received the washing by repentance. This man had to wait for the Lord himself, the light, to bring him sight. Does everybody get it? Hallelujah. So we see here that light opens eyes to see. Many eyes are still closed. Even people who are believers only have one eye open. They don't have both eyes open. And Genesis chapter 1. Oh, yes. Glory. I like when the Lord says something. You know, there's that, you know, ooh, snap. It's that snap moment. I'll tell you what he just said to me. He said, salvation brings one eye open. The baptism of the Holy Spirit brings both. Has everybody got it? Verse 1, Genesis 1. Let's speak it. In the beginning, God created heavens and earth. What's the first thing he created? Time. It says, in the beginning. Amen? Time was created first, and then the unseen and then the seen. The earth was out form and void, and darkness was what? On the face of the deep. So, God doesn't create anything without purpose or void, does he? He creates everything flourishing. So we understand that in between the two scriptures, because Lucifer used to be the praise and worship leader, and he used to be on the earth. The earth was known as the mountain of God. Pre-Adamic, there was angels and so forth. I'm not going to go way into this, because who the heck knew what was going on before you and I got here? We only know by the word of God, and God's revealed so much. But there's got to be more than just what's happening, amen? If he is forever and forever, he's been around a long time, which you and I can't comprehend because we're created in time, so it makes it difficult. So we only understand what's beginning and end. So every day we live a life that's beginning and end, beginning and end, beginning and end in this realm. But in an eternal purpose, an eternal realm, if you're truly connected, you don't live by beginning and end. You live by eternity. That's the difference of living in the physical flesh or living in the spirit. Those who are walking in the spirit utilize beginning and end and use it for the kingdom. And don't let it dictate them. See, time should not dictate you. Amen? It doesn't mean you don't skip work and stuff like that, you know. It means you don't show up late and stuff like, you know. So we see here that on the face of the earth, darkness. So when Lucifer rebelled, remember, Lucifer was a light bearer. He carried the light of the Lord with him. He was a light bearer. So when he sinned, he rebelled, he exalted himself. God removed that his light from him. He still carries the light, but it's not the true light. It's a false light. It's not the purity of light because Lucifer is now darkness. And so the Lord shut down the earth and darkness ruled over it. And the Spirit of God, who is light and life, was hovering over the face of the waters. In other words, God was getting ready to return light, which was once. And God said, let there be what? Light. And there was light. Remember, he did not create light. Because light, the sun was already there. It was covered. In other words, the earth was covered. When the word says, let there be, means to restore, not create. There's a difference. People always look at the scripture and go, oh, God created this. No, it was already created. And he said there, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day and the darkness called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. Now this is powerful. This is where the Lord first returned light that was already on the earth and it became darkness. This is the first return of light. Does everybody get it? And then he created man out of his what? Light. And it continued, but then man sinned and darkness took over again. So Jesus, the true light, had to come again. That's the return of the light. And again, so that means that you and I are part of the return of light. We are now not only a light bearers and light carriers, but we are the true light of eternity. Is everybody okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. Therefore, since we have this ministry as we have received mercy, we do not lose what? Heart. But we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness nor handling the word of God deceitfully by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. So the gospel is light, isn't it? Because those are recorded words of Jesus. Whose minds the God of this age has what? Blinded. Who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is in the image of God, should shine on them. So how can somebody be a believer and not read the word of God? See, you cannot, unless you eat light, you can't become light. You must eat light to become light. If you're eating false doctrines and religious doctrines, you're eating false light. And it's actually darkness. Anything that's not of truth is darkness. Amen? So you and I are to be eating the light so that we become light. Verse 5. So we do not what? We do not what? We do not preach ourselves, but what? Christ, Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake, For it is God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts and give the light of the knowledge of the Lord, glory of God in the face of who? In the face of Jesus. In the face of Jesus. Remember the gospel, the light of the gospel, the glory of Christ, who is in the image of God. Who is in the image of God should shine on me and you. But how's it going to shine? It's actually shining through us. The more we eat light, the more we become light, the more the character of Christ expresses through us. And then we are the ones who are the return of the light until the fulfillment of the true light takes over everything. Isaiah chapter 5. In verse 20. Is everybody there? Let's speak it, please. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. Wow. Woe without eternity. W-O-E. Woe. That ain't no horse woeing. That's a woe without eternity. Amen. So we see, we got an understanding here that as you and I eat light, we become light, we maintain light. There's a temporary light and there's an eternal light. Sun, the sun that was created, lights the temporary. And then we've got inventions of light and so forth. We're under a light bulb. And lights that, but they light temporary. But eternal light sees when the eternal light in me and you is shining, it's glowing, it's flowing. When the eternal light in me and you, our eyes are able to see through all the way. We're able to see. So our eyes, we're not short-sighted. We're eternally sighted. Why? Because we're always on a mission that we are eternally bound. Whatever we do, that's why we labor unto the Lord and so forth. Everything we do has got kingdom business. Everything. Everything is about kingdom business. How can I express the kingdom of God in everything I do, everyone I see, in conduct? In 1 John chapter 1. The return of light. First John chapter 1, verse 5. Is everybody there? Let's speak it, please. This is a message which we have heard from him and declare to you that God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. So there's no gray area. Amen. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we what? Lie. And do not practice the truth. So by not practicing the truth, it's going to begin to diminish the light. Why? Because practicing the truth is essential. If you're not eating the truth and putting it to practice, it has no effect. That's why the word says people receive the word without faith. Faith allows a spiritual sight. Why? Because you see yourself using what you're learning. Amen? If we say that we have fellowship with him and we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Again, practicing the truth by eating the light of the gospel and executing the word. That means that we're practicing the truth. We maintain eternal light and draw people into the light of Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians 11. It's like the enemy wants to come over and put a bag over you. You know? Cover you up. Doesn't want you to... does not want your light to shine. But he does that by getting you to agree with him on the inside. Because if the inside's light is not expressed and flowing and brilliant, it's not going to express outside. 2 Corinthians 11:12. All glory. Is everybody there? But what I do, I what? I will also continue to do, that I may cut off the opportunity of those who desire an opportunity to be regarded just as we are in the things of which they boast. In other words, there are people who are false light. They're actually darkness proclaiming light, but it isn't the true light. That's what the word tells us, that there's false doctrines, false prophets, false disciples. In verse 13, for such as are what? False apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself does what? Transforms himself into an angel of light. Satan does that. And Satan is reptilian. He's a serpent. Come on. He's darkness. But he has a false light. I don't know, he might carry a Bic or something, you know, and keep it lit. But it's a false light. And people are falling for it. So he does it by false doctrine. He gets people to eat false doctrine and lies, become religious. They have a form of religiosity, but deny the power of Christ. They don't know what the heck the truth is. And they're blinded. And look at, the enemy is drawing many people out now. Why? Because the body of Christ is piercing darkness now. And many people are being left out. Not willing to follow, not willing to fight. Not willing to press in. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, verse 15, it is no great thing if his what? Ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their work. Now, this is powerful. There's going to be those who have a form of righteousness. But they'll be false. They'll be lies. Because Satan's greatest weapon is deception, right? And he is the father of all lies. So he's going to infiltrate. He's going to try to get people to drawn to this deception. Think about your whole life and how many times that you've been into a place where you thought was, or you were talking to someone and you read something that sounded so wonderfully true, and you realized later it was a lie. I think that was the most freaking thing to me when I had my encounter with the Lord was, my God, were the words out of my mouth? I've been lied to my whole life because nobody knew the truth. And when people receive something that's a lie, even though they think it's true, they pass it on to generation to generation. But see, you and I have been called out of darkness to break all of those lies off so that we can turn around and penetrate darkness and rescue those who have been taken captive by deceptive doctrine. It is a responsibility. Amen? For much is given, much is required. Ooh. Revelation 3. Again, this is where we self-examine ourselves and begin to look at areas where we're exchanging some light for darkness and not even knowing it. Where we're allowing the enemy to take or to deceive us or diminish the light. Revelation 3 and verse 14. How many of y'all know associations bring impartations? That's why the word says don't hang around with those that are not light bearers. Those don't hang around with those that are lovers of the world. Don't hang around with them. Revelation 3:14, is everybody there? Let's speak it together. And to the angel of the church of Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen, the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I could wish you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Here's a warning. It's a warning. In other words, you and I got to be on fire for God all the time, no matter what. Amen? He says, because you say I am rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blinded, and naked, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in fire, that you may be rich in white garments, and that you may be clothed, and that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed. And anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may what? See. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore be what? Zealous and repent. In other words, turn away and come out of a lukewarm state of being. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to him and dine with him, and he will with me. And to him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. And he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Wow. In 1 Peter chapter 2. These are things that is something that's not we haven't heard before. Why? Because the Holy Spirit tells us things to come. He's always warning us. When we talked about a seared conscience. Man, if the enemy can get a seared conscience, man, you don't hear nothing. The only thing you hear is your fleshly desires. 1 Peter chapter 2. In verse 1, is everybody there? It speaketh, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious, coming to him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. Everyone say, I'm chosen.
I'm chosen.
I'm precious. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. What's a spiritual sacrifice? Praise and worship. Therefore, it is also contained in the Scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. And he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. In other words, he who follows him won't be put to shame. Therefore, if you believe, he is precious, but to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone and a stone of stumbling, a rock of offense. They stumble being what? Disobedient to the word to which they also were appointed. So in other words, they're not practicing what they've learned. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. That is me and you. Amen? Beloved, I beg you, sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, by which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Romans 13. The return of light. Everyone say, I'm the light. I've returned. Because you were once light, and you were born in darkness. Now you're returning back to light. So, you know, that's why you can say, I'll be back. Romans 13:11. Actually, it's I've come back. Let's speak it. Do this knowing the time that now is high time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. Why? Because that's going to steal your light. You know, one of the things in stealing light is one of the things the enemy loves to do. Again, we've shared this before about stealing your identity, people losing sight of who they really are. If he can steal that from you, he's got it. And so many people give it away. They sell their identity for the things of the world. Cast off the works of darkness. Amen. Proverbs 12. So will God correct us? Will he chasten us? Amen. So many people think that God corrects them because he's mad at them. He's not. He corrects us because he loves us. Proverbs chapter 12, yeah. In verse 1. Proverbs 12, verse 1. Whoever loves instruction loves knowledge. Everyone say, I love instruction.
I love instruction.
Whoever loves instruction loves knowledge, but he who hates corrections is stupid. I mean, let's be real, you know. He who hates correction is stupid. That's pretty straight and forward to the point. Yo, dummy. Verse 2. A good man obtains favor from the Lord, but a man of wicked intentions will what? Will what? He'll condemn him. So does God know your intentions?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you'll be judged by your intentions. A man is not established by wickedness, but the root of the righteous cannot be what? Moved. Let me tell you, when you're plugged in, you're plugged in. So as long as the enemy doesn't unplug you, you want to stay plugged in. Why? Because every one of us needs counsel, correction, and direction. Because what does it bring? Protection. Amen? So when you're corrected, don't let the enemy think, don't let them tell you you're bad. We're not bad. God never looks at us as being bad. Not that he might not look at us as being stupid sometimes. But stupid is a result of deception. Amen? Hallelujah. Acts 26. Acts 26. And there's a lot of stupid going around, let me tell you. In verse 17, Acts 26, and verse 17, this is for me and you. He says, I will deliver you from the Jewish people as well as from the Gentiles to whom I now send you. To what? To open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light. See, so he's sending us. The body of Christ is penetrating and pressing into darkness. To turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to who? To God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in Jesus. Wow. Wow. I want to go to Isaiah 61 for a second. Isaiah 61. We're going to decree this. Because you are, we're penetrating, we're pressing into darkness more to bring light. And I really, truly believe that this scripture is the manifested desire of God's will since the beginning of 2017. Isaiah 61, verse 1. Let's speak it. Is everybody there? Because we're going to decree this. Amen?
Amen?
All right. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, and a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be what? That he may be glorified. Now go to the next part. And they will rebuild the old ruins. In other words, God is going to use us to rebuild things. They shall rise up from former desolations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the desolations of many generations. Strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. The sons of the foreigner shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers. You shall be named the priests of the Lord. They shall call you the servants of our God. You shall eat the riches of the Gentiles, and in their glory you shall boast. Instead of your shame, you shall have double honor. Instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery for burnt offering. I will direct their work in truth. I will make them an everlasting covenant. Their descendants shall be known among the Gentiles, and their offspring the people. All who see them shall acknowledge them. They are the posterity whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be rejoiceful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with the ornaments, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For the earth brings forth its bud, as the garden causes things that are sown in to spring forth. So the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. And again, in Jesus' name. This is what's happening right now. Righteousness is beginning to rule. God is going to allow righteousness to rule for a period of time, even though darkness rules the earth. Has everybody got it? Darkness still will rule the earth, but righteousness is rising up and eating up darkness right now. We're eating it up. We're penetrating. We're going in. 2 Thessalonians 2. Oh, hallelujah. The return of light. Verse 1. Of course, this will be preparation for the final return of the true light. Amen. Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, as we ask you, do not be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ has come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Let me tell you something. There is so much deception out there of false doctrines and religions. People are going all over the place, trying to look for truth. But we have been told from the beginning of, that we've come into this world that Jesus was not truth. Does everybody get that? I mean, people said it, but there has been no revelation of it to us because of the areas of the places that we've been brought up in religion, whatever. They've talked about Jesus as being religious. They talked about Jesus as being the Son of God, but never revealing to him as God. As the Word that became flesh and came in, as bringing the power of the Holy Spirit, that he was the anointed one, his anointing, the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty. Not telling them that there's a heaven and hell, but telling them that there's a purgatory and a place of rest before you make a choice. I mean, come on, let's get real. Decreeing about a pope, people worshiping a man, all these false doctrines and religious things that distract people and mislead them without recognizing the power of Christ in them and through them. There's so much more for me and you. And the enemy's always trying to deaden things, prevent us from growing, stop growth, mislead, distract, or steal. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy, doesn't he? There are so many doctrines that are out there that are just ridiculous. And you've got all these denominations. All of these denominations are associated with a doctrine. God doesn't look at those things. He doesn't care about those things. He's looking at a person's heart. The problem is most people don't know their own heart. They may think, I'm okay. When you think you're okay, you're dangerous. None of us is okay. Amen? None of us. Oh, hallelujah. There is a falling away that's begun. It's been going on for a while now. The word tells us something specific, that there'll be doctrines of demons deceiving and seducing seductive spirits in the latter days. We are in the latter days. This is end time. We're the final generation. Some people just don't get that yet. They don't believe it. Let's go a little further. Verse 5. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things, and now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time? For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. Who's restraining? We are. The body of Christ that's on this earth is restraining. Why? That's why we're pressing into darkness. We're actually restraining darkness. But once we're removed from here, you don't want to be left behind. Verse 8, then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will what? Consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with his brightness at of his what? His coming. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, lying, wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish because they do not receive the love of the truth that they may be saved. For this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie and that they may be condemned who do not believe the truth but at pleasure in unrighteousness. But you and I are not bound, but you and I are bound to give thanks to God always for you, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through what? Sanctification or separation from darkness by the Spirit and belief in the truth. 1 Thessalonians 5. And let's speak at verse 1. But concerning the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness so that this day should overtake you as a thief, unless you're in darkness, right? You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love as a helmet of hope and salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. That's powerful. And I'm going to close at Revelation 21. The return of the light. Revelation 21, verse 22. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. But I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city had need of no need of the sun, or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light. The nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. Its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there, and they shall bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. But there shall by no means enter it anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. This is the temple that's coming. There will be no sun, no moon. The Lord will be the light. That will be the final return of the light. Amen? And we'll be all joined together as light in oneness. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. We ask that the seed be imparted in each and every one, so that it may grow and bear fruit for your glory. And revelation that we are from the eternal light, not a temporary. Where your word says, he who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. That your light brings life and brings sight. So let us see things through according to your will and not our own. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.